Hello friends, in today's video, we will learn about Environment Protection Act. So in India, the values of protecting environment and the need for conservation of our ecosystem and environment is enshrined in the Constitution itself. For example, in the Directive Principles of State Policy in DPSP, we have provisions in Article 48 regarding the protection of environment. And thereafter, our country India has been giving due importance to environment protection through various measures that it undertakes. India has enacted plenty of laws or acts in order to protect environment in its entirety. So we will be learning in this module different environment legislations that were enacted in India. We will be specifically focusing on five of environmental legislations: the Environment Protection Act 1986, the Air Prevention and Control of Pollution Act 1981, Water Prevention and Control of Pollution Act 1974, then Wildlife Protection Act 1972, and finally, Forest Conservation Act. There are plenty of other laws that are existing in India, but we will be focusing on these five legislations in India that are there to protect environment in different forms. First, let us see the Environment Protection Act of 1986 and its salient features. So, in the wake of Bhopal tragedy that happened in 1984, the Government of India enacted the Environment Protection Act of 1986. This act provides for the protection and improvement of environment. As its name suggests, the objective of this act is to protect environment. And the purpose of the act is to implement the decisions of United Nations Conference on Human Environment of 1972. So this conference was of particular importance because this was the first time that the protection of environment was recognized internationally. So we know from the Industrial Revolution onwards, from the 18th, 19th century onwards, the destruction of environment for industrial as well as development purposes was exponentially increasing. And in the 20th century, we can see the huge increase of population and the exploitation of the environment was causing huge damage to environment. And as the progress of human being continued to evolve in the 1900s, in the 1960s, and in 1970s, specifically, people began to realize that the environment is not for our selfish needs. Environmental resources will deplete if we continuously exploit these resources. So until then, people had this concept that the environmental resources will not deplete and we can continuously use these resources forever and exploit them. But people began to realize in the 1960s and 70s that these resources will deplete and there will be numerous problems such as environmental pollution, then other damages to the environment, depletion of resources will be there, and such kinds of problems began to arise in the 1960s and 70s. Later, people started to focus on other universal problems such as global warming, then the ozone depletion, etc. So this idea was not there, ozone depletion. So these ideas are quite common now. We are concerned about these terms in the recent era. But previously, before many years, these terms were not discussed that much. Everybody thought environment is there always as it is and we can continuously exploit nature. So nature was thought as a giver of resources for every human being. But now we know we have to protect the environment, then only we can use it sustainably. So these thoughts were there in the 1960s and 70s internationally, and there were conventions happening in the international platform regarding to this concept, regarding the protection of environment. And hence, after these years, 1960s and 70s, you can see plenty of environmental acts being enacted in India. For example, the 1986 Environment Protection Act is an aftermath of an international movement that was happening to protect the environment in its entirety. So this act, Environment Protection Act, is one of the umbrella act that is existing in India that covers plenty of other legal measures and plenty of other policies for the protection of environment. This act is an all-in-all act for every other policies and measures relating to environment protection. So I hope you got a broad understanding about the context of implementing these acts. Now moving on with the salient features of the act. So since we are quoting from the act itself, the words that we use will be a little bit difficult. Maybe the sentences are framed in a more legal manner. So simply we can try to understand the basic concept of these features. So the first of all, the main emphasis of the act is given to environment, which is understood in a very wide term under the Environment Act. So according to this act, environment includes water, air and land, as well as their interrelationship which exists between water, air and land and human beings, other living creatures, plants, microorganisms and property. So this act tries to consider environment in a holistic manner, not only the physical features of the environment but also the interrelationship between these factors are considered in this act. Then the act defines environmental pollution. So environmental pollution is defined in this act as the presence of pollutants defined as solid, liquid or gaseous substance present in such a concentration as may be or may tend to be injurious to environment. So this act tries to define what is an environmental pollution. But now we know pollution, what is pollution? It is now a common term in our country and in many nations. But then it was important to define what is an environmental pollution in order to prevent it. Now the act empowers the central government to take all appropriate measures to prevent and control pollution and to establish effective machinery for the purpose of protecting and improving the quality of the environment and controlling and abating environmental pollution. So simply, this act gives many powers to the central government for protecting the environment. So it can take plenty of measures and it can formulate machineries for the purpose of protecting environment. The act explicitly prohibits discharge of environmental pollutants in excess of prescribed regulatory standards. So this is the legal background which prohibits discharging of environmental pollutants in excessive quantities. So this act actually legalizes the punishment for those kinds of acts. The act prescribes a special procedure for handling hazardous substances, and the concerned person has to handle the hazardous substances according to the procedure of the act. So when handling hazardous substances, which are hazardous for the environment, special procedures as mentioned in the act is to be followed. And there is also a specific prohibition against handling hazardous substances except those in compliance with the regulatory procedures and standards. So other kinds of handling of hazardous substances are banned according to this act. This act also empowers and authorizes the central government to issue directions for the operation or process, prohibition, closure or regulation of any industry. So So, central government can take actions against industry in the context of environmental pollution or affecting the environment. So, it is authorized to stop, regulate the supply of electricity or water or any other service directly without obtaining the order of court. So, government can take action on its own. It need not consult a court with regard to the matters of environment pollution. The Act consists of and deals with more stringent penal provisions. So, if somebody is violating any of the provisions of the Act also prescribes punishment. For example, the punishment up to 5 years of imprisonment and fine up to 1 lakh or both is provided for many of the violations of provisions of this Act. Then other features are the central government or any other person duly authorized is empowered to collect samples of air, water or soil or other substances as evidence of the offenses under the Environment Protection Act. So the central government can collect the samples for evidence. Then Environmental Act 1986 grants immunity to the officers of the government for any act done under the provisions of this Act or under the powers vested in them or functions assigned to them under this Act. So this Act offers for immunity to the officers of the government for anything done under this Act. And then the Act debars the civil courts from having any jurisdiction to entertain any suit or proceeding in respect of any action, direction, order issued by the central government or other statutory authority under this Act. So, it even debars the civil courts from having jurisdiction pertaining to these matters. And under the Act, there will be supremacy of provision. That means if there is any other provision that is contradictory to the provision of this Act, the provision of this Act will have supremacy. So, sometimes there might be other act in which it is mentioned that a hazardous substance can be handled in some way. But according to this act, supports the hazardous substance cannot be handled in that way, then that means this act is to be followed. This act has the supremacy over every other act. So these are the salient features of Environment Protection Act. So the words used in this in these sentences, and the sentences are complex just because they are taken out from a legislation, from an act. It is quite common to mention all these in a complicated sentence in the legislations as well as act. So you do not have to worry about that. You can try to simply understand the concept of each of these features. For example, you can try to understand the first point as the act emphasizes on environment and tries to protect it. It defines environment in a holistic manner. Then it defines environmental pollution like this. Then the Act gives powers to central government to take actions with regard to environment pollution and environment protection. Then it prohibits discharge of environmental pollutants. Then lay down special procedure for handling hazardous substances and prohibits handling hazardous substances in any other way. Then the Act authorizes central government for controlling the operations of industries. Then punishments are laid down by this Act. Then the government can collect samples as evidence according to this Act. Then if any officers are taking actions under this Act, they have immunity. That means they cannot be made victims just because of something they have done under this Act. And it debars the civil courts from entertaining any suit or proceedings in relation to these matters. And finally, this Act has supremacy of provision. This Act is above any other Act which is contradictory to this Act. So you can just try to simply understand the meaning of these sentences and write in a simple manner. So as of now, I hope you got a broad understanding about the Environmental Protection Act, and we have all also seen the context of implementation of this Act. Thank you.